everyone! Welcome back to IntegralCalc.com. Today we're going to be doing another partial fractions problem, and in this one we're going to be dealing with repeated quadratic factors. We've in fact got a mix of factors. We have a linear factor, which is x right here. We also have a quadratic factor, x squared plus 1, and the fact that we have the quantity x squared plus 1 squared makes this a repeated factor. Realize, right, that if it's x squared plus 1 squared, it's the same thing as x squared plus 1 times x squared plus 1, which makes it repeated, right? This x squared plus 1 factor occurs once and then twice. Since it occurs twice in our denominator, it's a repeated factor. So dealing with repeated factors makes this a little bit of a special problem. Whenever we're doing a partial fractions problem, we want to take our fraction exactly as it exists inside of our integral and put it over here on the left-hand side of this equation that we're going to put together. So x to the fourth plus 1, and then we take our denominator exactly as it is, x squared plus 1 squared, and we put that on the left-hand side. Now on the right-hand side, we're going to start developing the decomposition of this partial fractions problem. So first we're going to deal with the linear factor, which is x. Since it's a linear factor, we just have to put a over x. Whenever you've got a linear factor, you just put the single constant here, a over x. Then for the quadratic factor, x squared plus 1, since it's a repeated factor, we have to treat it differently than a distinct factor or a non-repeated factor. So remember that if you've got a repeated factor, for example, if you had a repeated factor, x to the fourth, right? That's repeated because it's x times x times x times x. It's actually repeated four times. In your partial fractions decomposition, you have to include the factor x to the fourth, but you also have to include the factors x to the third, x squared, and x, or x to the first power. In this case, we have the repeated factor x squared plus 1 squared, so we have to include that as a factor, but we also have to include x squared plus 1 to the first power. So basically, if you have a repeated factor, you have to include every factor of a lesser degree than the factor that you've been given in the problem, right? So if we've got 4, we have to include 3, 2, and 1. If we've got 2, we have to include 1 as well. So we need to include the factor x squared plus 1 squared and the factor x squared plus 1 to the first power. So since these are both quadratic factors, when you've got a linear factor, you can just put the variable like this, a, in the numerator. When you have a quadratic factor, you have to put two constants and this variable in this form, bx plus c. So you've got bx plus c, and then we'll divide that by the first order factor, which is just going to be x squared plus 1 to the first power. Then we have the second quadratic factor, so we'll put dx plus e and put that over the second quadratic factor, which is x squared plus 1 squared, right? So now we've included both degrees of that repeated factor, and we've got quadratic factors indicated here in the numerator with these forms. So now that we've set up our decomposition, we need to multiply both sides of this equation by the entire denominator of the left-hand side. So we're going to multiply every term on the left and the right-hand side by x times the quantity x squared plus 1 squared. When we do that, obviously our entire denominator on the left-hand side will cancel and we'll just be left with x to the fourth plus 1. On the right-hand side, this x in the denominator will cancel with this x, so we'll be left with a times x squared plus 1 squared. When we multiply this bx plus c term by the denominator from the left, this x squared plus 1 term will cancel, and we'll be left with bx plus c times x squared plus 1 to the first power. Then when we multiply by dx plus e, that entire x squared plus 1 squared term will cancel, so we'll just get dx plus e times x. So now that we've multiplied through everything, notice that the denominators on both sides of this equation have completely disappeared. What we need to do now is use algebra to multiply out all of these things together. And I'm going to go ahead and skip that part in this problem because the algebra is just pretty tedious. But basically what you want to do is multiply everything out, and the step you'll get to when you multiply everything together is ax to the fourth plus 2ax squared, fix that plus sign, 2ax squared plus a plus bx to the fourth plus bx squared plus cx cubed plus cx plus dx squared plus ex. So when you multiply everything out, this is what you get. What you want to do now is go ahead and collect like terms. So we're going to collect all of our x to the fourth terms together, all of our x to the third terms together, x squared terms together, etc. So, and I'll just go ahead and cross these off as I go so that we make sure we don't miss any. So we have this a times x to the fourth, and we have b times x to the fourth. So what we can do is actually, if we collected those together, ax to the fourth and bx to the fourth, we would have ax to the fourth plus bx to the fourth. If we factor out x to the fourth, we'll get a plus b times x to the fourth, right? And now these two are done. Now if we collect x cubed terms, there's only one of them, so we'll get plus c times x cubed. Now we want to look at our x squared terms. We've got 2ax squared, and we have a bx squared and a dx squared. Again, if we collect those together and then factor out the x squared, we'll get 2a plus b plus d times x squared. 2ax squared, bx squared, and dx squared. Now if we collect our x terms together, we'll get cx and ex. Again, factoring out the x, we'll get c plus e times x. So there's those two. And then we just have to get our constants together. The only thing that's left is a. So we just go ahead and say plus a. So that's how we factor things out. And the reason that we do that is because when we use this method for partial fractions, in order for the left-hand side and the right-hand side of this equation to be equal to one another, we know, for example, because the coefficient on the x to the fourth term on the left-hand side is 1, right? This is 1x to the fourth. We know that 1 has to be equal to the coefficient on the x to the fourth term on the right-hand side. So 1 has to be equal to a plus b. We also know that the constant over here on the left-hand side, 1, has to be equal to a, because a is the constant on the right-hand side. And now we also know that coefficient c, this coefficient 2a plus b plus d, and this coefficient c plus e, all have to be equal to 0 since there are no x cubed, x squared, or x terms on the left-hand side of our equation. So given that, we can go ahead and write a series of simultaneous equations so that we can solve for the variables a through e. So again, we said that a plus b was going to be equal to 1. We know that c is equal to 0. We know that 2a plus b plus d is equal to 0. We know that c plus e is equal to 0. And we know that a is equal to 1. So we want to go ahead and solve for the variables a through e. And I'll go ahead and write a legend up here so that we can have a place to keep them. So a through e. We already know that a is equal to 1. We already know that c is equal to 0. If we go ahead and plug a equals 1 into this equation, we'll get 1 plus b equals 1. Subtracting b from both sides gives us b equals 0. So we know that b is equal to 0. We can find e by plugging c into this equation. So we know c is equal to 0, so we get 0 plus e equals 0. And we can see right away that we'll get e equals 0. Then if we want to find D, we can go ahead and plug A and B into this equation. A is 1, so we'll get 2 here. B is 0, so 2 plus 0 plus D equals 0. So we'll get 2 plus D equals 0, which means that we'll get D equals negative 2. So those are our constants. So now we can take those and we can plug them back in. Let's go ahead and erase this stuff. We don't need it anymore. Since we know our coefficients, we can go ahead and plug them back into our integral. So we have the integral from 1 to 2. Instead of this nasty fraction here that we were given in our original problem, we're going to use everything over here on the right-hand side, the decomposition, along with the coefficients we just found, and put that back into our integral instead. So we know A is 1, so we're going to get 1 over x plus B and C are both 0, so we'll get 0x plus 0 over x squared plus 1. Then D and E are negative 2 and 0 respectively, so we'll get negative 2x plus 0 over the quantity x squared plus 1 squared dx. And now this is actually something we can integrate. This entire second term here, obviously you can see we're going to get 0 in the denominator, so this is going to go away. And what we're left with is the integral from 1 to 2 of 1 over x, and I'm going to go ahead and split these apart into two separate integrals so that we can easily deal with them one at a time. Then we're going to have a negative 2x over x squared plus 1 squared, so we can go ahead and say minus 2 times the integral from 1 to 2 of x over the quantity x squared plus 1 squared dx. So I just brought this negative 2 here out in front of the integral and simplified it that way. So now that we've got this, we can go ahead and integrate the first term easily. We know that the integral of 1 over x is the natural log of the absolute value of x. So we're going to evaluate that on the range 1 to 2. And then for the second integral, we know that we can use u substitution. We can see it here in this x squared plus 1 term. So if we set u equal to x squared plus 1, and then if we take the derivative to get du, we'll get 2x dx. Solving for dx gives us dx equals du over 2x. So if we plug that substitution back into our integral, we'll end up with x over u squared, and then we know that dx is equal to du over 2x. So you can see that the x's here are going to cancel. So what we're left with, let's go ahead and just continue doing this one step at a time. We'll go ahead and evaluate the natural log on the range 2 to 1. So to do that, we'll plug in 2 first, and then subtract and plug in the lower limit of integration, 1. So that's taken care of. We've evaluated that. Now we've got minus 2. And we can go ahead and take this 2 right here and bring it out. In fact, let's do that right now. We can bring it out in front of our integral. And since we have minus 2 and we're bringing this one out in front, it's in the denominator, we actually end up with a minus 1. So those 2's cancel. And we're just left with the integral from 1 to 2 of 1 over u squared du. And since we have 1 over u squared, we can turn that into u to the negative 2. Remember that if you have 1 over like x to the a, that's the same thing as saying x to the negative a. You can move it into the numerator by changing the sign on the exponent. So we're going to go ahead and say that this is the integral of u to the negative 2 du, and that'll make it easier for us to integrate. So now that we've gotten this far, we'll have the natural log of the absolute value of 2. We know that the natural log of the absolute value of 1 is just 0. So we can go ahead and get rid of this term. Then we have minus the integral from, actually we're going to go ahead and integrate right now. So when we integrate u to the negative 2, we'll add 1 to the exponent, right? So negative 2 plus 1 is a negative 1, but then we have to divide by our new exponent. So our new exponent is negative 1, so we need to divide by negative 1 like this, and then we're going to be evaluating this on the range 1 to 2. Okay, so now natural log of the absolute value of 2, we've got negative and a negative, so this is going to be a plus u to the negative 1, and instead of u to the negative 1, we'll move that back to the denominator, so we'll get 1 over u. We need to evaluate this on the range 1 to 2. So now we know that u is x squared plus 1, we can go ahead and plug that back in for u. So plus 1 over x squared plus 1, and again we'll need to evaluate from 1 to 2. So plugging in our upper limit of integration, 2, we'll get 1 over 2 squared is 4 plus 1 is 5. Then we'll subtract and plug in the lower limit of integration. So 1 over 1 squared is 1 plus 1 is 2. So we've got that. And now we just need to find a common denominator here. So we can use a common denominator of 10, which means we're going to get 2 over 10 here. This is going to be 5 over 10. So we end up with 2 tenths minus 5 tenths, which is a negative 3 tenths. And so we'll get a plus negative 3 tenths, which of course we can just simplify to natural log of the absolute value of 2 minus 3 tenths. And that's it. That's our final answer. So that's how we use partial fractions with repeated quadratic factors to solve, to solve and get our final answer. So that's it. I hope this video helped you guys, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!